This is how we do it.
What's up, Living Church? Good morning. So glad that you guys are here. This is the last week of our series. This is how we do it. You know, all of us have certain ways that we do things. You go to a certain restaurant, they do it a certain way. I was reminded of this week. If you drive through the drive-thru at Whataburger here in Mansfield, you're going to realize that there's a way that they do it compared to how Chick-fil-A does in their drive-thru. Have you been to the drive-thru here at Whataburger? It'll take you 25 minutes. They get your order wrong every time. Come on, they need to bring me in to consult how to fix some of their systems. I don't know. But then you go to the Chick-fil-A drive-thru, and it's like magic. It's amazing. They get it right. They give you some free little mints. They say, have a nice day. The only frustrating thing about the Chick-fil-A drive-thru is they have those two lines. And you know that other person is always trying to get in front of you to get in line after you ordered? That'd be making me, I know it's y'all, and it'd make me mad sometimes. But every different restaurant has a way that they do things. You know, in your marriage, there's a certain way that things are done. Rachel knows how to do things this way, and I know how to do things the way that she likes, and we understand in our home, this is how we do it. And just this last week, we realized that we were on different pages about something. I had celebrated my birthday this last week, and thank you for the hundreds of you that wrote me cards or sent me a message and spoke words of encouragement to me. It means more than you know. But as we were getting ready to go to a birthday party, Rachel bought some cake and some ice cream, and so I was loading it all in the truck. And I realized that we hadn't communicated properly. The cake was on point. The cake was good. But then she bought that vanilla ice cream that's like 5 pounds for 95 cents. And it's made of like milk and fructose corn syrup and styrofoam. It's that kind of ice cream. And I was like, baby, this is not how we do it. It's my birthday. Where's the bluebell? Can I get a witness, right? And so we realized that we had to re-figure out that this is how we do it. So I was like, I'm going to be late for my own birthday party, right? I'm going to get some ice cream and then say hallelujah while I'm eating it after my meal. But every family has a certain way that they do things. And through this series at Living Church, we've been talking about how we do what we do. Why do we do the things that we do? And, you know, we work hard to build a church that's based off of the blueprint that God gave us. Jesus, throughout his life, left many examples for us about how we need to do the things that we do. And so we've been looking at the examples that Jesus left. The first week, we looked at the example Jesus left about communion, that when we take communion together, that we need to have a moment to review ourselves, that we need to have a moment to remember what Christ has done for us. Then we need to have a moment to be reunited with the people that are around us and realize that there's equal level ground at the foot of the cross. Yeah. Then we looked at the reminder that Jesus gave us about prayer. We talked about the power of prayer and laying on of hands, that throughout Jesus' life, that he would interact with people, that he would not just talk to them, but he would touch them, right, that through the laying on of hands, miraculous things could happen, that Jesus was able to heal through a touch, that he could bless through a touch, he could provide for a touch. And that's the reason that we have prayer partners come up every single week so that we can be in community together, so that we can pray for one another. Then last week, Pastor Whitney did such a fantastic job talking to us about the power of community, about how Jesus gave us an example about how we need to walk in community. Jesus started his earthly ministry. The first thing that he did was gather some guys around him. He got a small group to come around him and help him accomplish what God had called him to do. God himself lives in community, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They give us this example of community. So that's how we do it. And last week was the kickoff of our life group semester here in the new year, and it was amazing. How many of you guys went to life group this last week? So many. You know, we had 17 adult life groups and 4 student life groups. That's exciting. Last week in the launch, we were up 35% from any other number we've ever had at life group. So 35% growth. That's incredible. But the stat that gets me most excited is that 40% of our church last week attended life groups. 40% of us that call Living Church home said, you know what, I'm not just going to go on Sunday, but I'm going to get connected in community. Now, I would love it when someday we have 120% going to life group. So everybody who calls Living Church home and then people that are wanting to learn about Jesus, they would come evangelistically. We'll get there, right? We're growing there. But man, so excited, so celebrating that this week. But another example that Jesus left us in his life that we're talking about today, this is how we do it, is in water baptism. Yeah. Everyone say water baptism. It's what we're talking about today. In Matthew chapter 3, Jesus gets baptized. It says this. It says, then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. Now, the Jordan River was a very public place. This was a place that a lot of commerce would happen. People would set up booths and tents and be selling things by the water. They would come to get water. They would come to wash clothes. It was a place that was very busy. So Jesus didn't get baptized in some hidden back room, but he got baptized in the public for everybody to see what he was doing. It goes on, it says, but John tried to deter him, saying, I need to be baptized by you, but you come to me? You see, earlier in Scripture, John says that he's not even holy enough to lace up Jesus' sandals. But Jesus comes to him and says, hey, I want you to baptize me. Jesus says, let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this to fulfill all righteousness. You see, Jesus was holy, Jesus was pure, but the reason that he was getting baptized was to be obedient to the direction of the Father. And it says, then John consented. John's like, all right, fine, Jesus, you got me. And he says, as soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. So if Jesus came up out of the water, that means that he had to go down into the water, right? And so he was fully submerged. So here at Living Church, we have a very literal view of baptism that we believe in full immersion. We don't sprinkle, we dunk you. It's Dunkin' Donut Day, right? We dunk you. We let you know that we're fully submerged, just like Jesus gave us the example. And it says, at that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending as a dove and a light on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my son, who I love. Sounded like Optimus Prime. Didn't really sound like God, right? He said, God says, this is my son, whom I love. With him, I am well pleased. God was pleased because of the obedience that Jesus stepped out in. Now, this is an amazing portion of Scripture that I don't have time to get into, but we see all three different personalities, all three different pieces of the Godhead. We see the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit all here in one moment. And this was a transitionary moment for Jesus. Jesus steps from obscurity into his public ministry. Jesus goes from being a carpenter's son to becoming the Christ. Christ was not Jesus' last name. It wasn't like Mary and Joseph Christ, right? Christ means Savior, Redeemer, Healer of the world. So he's going from the carpenter to the Christ in this moment. It's a moment of transition. And baptism for us today, it's a moment of transition. It's where God is saying that the old us is gone and that the new us is here. Come on, somebody. That the old us has been passed away, but the new us is now alive and able to accomplish everything that God has for us. So here's what he did. He got baptized in a public place. He was obedient to the process. The Father was pleased, and a transition occurred because of it. So the Bible tells us that he was baptized by John the Baptist. John the Baptist is kind of a quirky guy. If you read the Scripture, the Bible says that he lived out in the desert, that he wore camel fur, that he ate locusts and wild honey. So he's kind of a non-traditional preacher. But John the Baptist, it's his voice that broke the prophetic silence from the Old Testament to the New Testament. He broke the silence. He's the one that came and said, repent, repent, for the day of the Lord is near. And then he introduces Jesus, that behold the Lamb of God. And so John the Baptist is an integral character for all of us to understand to the transition of Jesus coming in as the Messiah. He was also the cousin of Jesus, which is an interesting fact. We know this because when Mary got pregnant, remember at Christmas? So Mary gets pregnant, she freaks out, what, an angel showed up to me? The first person she runs to is to her cousin Elizabeth. The Bible tells us that Elizabeth was 6 months pregnant before Mary with John the Baptist. And it says this, Luke chapter 1, verse 41, when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Because Jesus, as an embryo, was inside Mary and walked into the home, this baby influenced Elizabeth and John the Baptist, and they were both filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, I don't have time to get into this, but you can't tell me that there's not power in that womb, that there's not something happening inside that womb, that God's hand is already on Jesus, and if he's already able to do the miraculous before he was born, come on, there's a connection between what's in the womb and who's in heaven. But I'm going to talk about that later. We're working on a series that God's already laid on my heart. I think we'll do it sometime near the end of 2019 called It's Tricky. It's tricky, right? There are some tricky things in this world that we need to be aware of and that the church needs to be confident enough to speak about, but I need some time to get all those thoughts in order and then come get in a fight with some people. And so we'll do that. So Jesus is baptized by John the Baptist, and Jesus speaks about John a little bit in Matthew 11, verse 11. He says this, "I tell you the truth, out of all who ever lived, none is greater than John the Baptist." So John the Baptist is a great guy, but he has this title, John the Baptist. That's his title. The reason he was called that is not because he went to a Baptist church. Like, I don't know, but I don't think that they had Southern Baptist in first century Jerusalem. That's not something that I think existed. The reason he was called John the Baptist is because he would go around and baptize people. It was a title that he had. And when we hear the word baptize, it has a lot of spiritual connotation. It has a lot of stuff attached to it, and mostly based on our original experience. Maybe the church that we grew up in, or something we saw on television, or something we heard about it. When we hear baptism, we think something really spiritual. But in this day, in the first century, the word baptism was just a word that was used all the time, baptizo, and it meant to be washed. It just meant to be washed. We found, archaeologists have found a lot of extra biblical text with the word baptizo in it. There's a parchment that they found where somebody was explaining how to dye fabric. And when you would dye fabric, you would have to take the fabric and baptizo it in the dye. There was a writing that they found about some ships being transported, and one of the ships sunk, and it said the ship was baptizoed. Archaeologists found an old cookbook, and in the cookbook it says that before you cooked vegetables, that you had to baptizo them, that you had to wash them. So this is a very common word. So John's real name back then was John the Washer, John the Cleaner, John the Janitor, that he would come along, and he was like a spiritual janitor who would come in, and he would clean up some messes, that he would baptize people. And you see, it was a symbol that the washing had occurred in our life. Baptism, the washing from baptism, it doesn't wash away external filth, but it washes away internal filth. See, it's not about taking a physical bath. It's about taking a spiritual bath and realizing that some things have been washed off of your life. And so we love being clean. We love, right? We love being clean. We don't want to be dirty. And so this week I spent a little time and walked around my house with a big box, and I picked up a bunch of things that that I had in my house to help everything be clean. We want our clothes to be clean, right? And so we've got to have some laundry soap, and then we want to be soft and smell good, and so we've got to get some softener. We want to make sure that the dishes that we eat off of are clean, and so we've got some dish washer soap, and then we've got to make sure that the car that we're driving is clean, right? And so we want to have our tires all clean, and we've got some car wash. It's not enough for the outside of the car to be clean. We've got to make sure the inside of the car is clean. And so then I was like, well, you know, the windows of my house, I want the windows to be clean, and the mirrors in my bathroom. And so then I've got to make sure that I'm clean. So I got to grab my Pertz Plus, right? 2-in-1. Come on, somebody. And so got to make sure that I'm clean. And then I got to make sure that I'm clean. I smell good. So I got my Old Spice Swagger, right? And so I get that. And then just to reach all the difficult places, you know, you got a little special brush, right? Oh, this goes over here with the dish soap. And so then, you know, you got to be clean everywhere, and so you got to have some toilet paper, right? You got to keep that clean, and every once in a while you need a little Southern hospitality, and so you get, you know, a little extra wipes, and you want your teeth to be clean, right? And so you get some toothpaste and some toothbrushes, and so after you get out of the shower, you got to make sure your ears are clean, so you got your Q-tips, and so all of these things are in all of our houses to help us be clean. So we understand the value of being clean, and John the Baptist, John the Washer, he's telling us that baptism is not an external cleaning, but it's an internal, a spiritual cleaning. Now, as a kid, all of these different things were in my house growing up, and then I saw something on television that amazed me. It was a product called OxyClean. You remember OxyClean? My boy Billy Mays, he would show up and he'd start doing his infomercial talking about how no matter what's happening, OxyClean will come and it will clean that thing in your life. And I used to love these infomercials as a kid. As a matter of fact, I would pretend like I was doing infomercials when people came around. There's videos of me as a little kid doing these infomercials, and I would say, "Hi, my name is Trustin Babb, and I'd like to sell you OxyClean, the cleaning specialist. It doesn't matter what's happening in your situation, the OxyClean can come along and clean it." And I'd say, "It doesn't matter if you have a problem and if you have any grass stains, OxyClean can come and clean that thing up. It doesn't matter if you have any dirt stains. The dirt stain, OxyClean is powerful enough. It doesn't matter if you have any food stains. If you spill some food in your situation, it doesn't matter. You get it in your carpet, get it in your bedspread, get it in your clothes. OxyClean can clean it for you. OxyClean is so powerful that it can take out greasy stains like motor oil. OxyClean can handle it for you. It doesn't matter if you spill coffee on your favorite blouse. OxyClean can clean it for you. As a matter of fact, it can even handle things like pet stains. I don't want to put dog poop in here, right? This is the best that I could do. And I'd say OxyClean can take out stains like a vacuum cleaner. It will suck out. It's even special enough to be delicate on your most delicate pieces of clothing. And I tell you that if you call now, I'll not only send you one container of OxyClean for $19.99, but if you call the number on the bottom of the screen right now, I'll send you a free one-year supply of OxyClean for one payment of $19.99. But wait, there's more. If you call now, I'm going to throw in 3 ShamWows, 15 ceramic kitchen knives, and a free Lamborghini. Call now, right? And so we see these commercials and we get so excited about OxyClean because of what it can do. Because when you would understand the power of OxyClean, you're calling that number.
Right.
You're the power of oxygen. Right. What does that even mean? I don't know, but send some of that to my house, right? When you understand the power of OxyClean, you would order it. But can I tell you that when you understand the power of the blood of Jesus Christ in your life, that he can clean up any stain, any situation in your life? As a kid, we would sing, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. That's old. Y'all don't know it, right? We would sing about the power of the blood. We would talk about the power of the blood of the Lamb because the truth is, Jesus will wash away any sickness, any different thing in your life. The power of the blood of Jesus, it'll wash away shame. The power of the blood of Jesus, it can wash away your insecurity. The power of the blood of Jesus will wash away any hurt that's crept into your life. The power of the blood of Jesus will wash away your fear. It will wash away your sin. And it can even come in and it can wash away death in your situation. This is the power of the blood of Jesus. This is what we celebrate baptism for. And I think that if Jesus were here doing an infomercial, he would say, and if you call now, I'll give you an eternal supply, not for $59.99, not for $19.99, but for free. That he's going to give us something free to clean up no matter what kind of mess walks into our life. That this is what baptism is about. This is how we do it. We understand that the blood of Jesus, it does more for us than we can even understand. And it's not just in a funny illustration or in a song or in an infomercial from the 80s. It's in the Bible. Revelation chapter 1, verse 5, it says, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7, it says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our sins. Matthew 26, 28, Pastor Brandon read this when he talked about communion. He says, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for the many for the forgiveness of sins. Yeah. You see, baptism is a representation of the washing away of your sins. It's a representation. I want to make sure that we're all on the same page theologically and biblically. Salvation is independent from baptism. I want you to understand that. That there are two separate things. Baptism is not something that we have to do to secure our salvation. We are saved by grace through faith. That's how we are saved. John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son that whoever believed in him would not perish but have everlasting life. It doesn't say believed in him and then gets baptized. Salvation and baptism are independent from each other. Romans chapter 10, it says this, if you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. There's two things there. Then it goes on and reiterates it. It says, for it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved.
Right.
Everyone, that's good news because I fall into that category, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. I think the most commonly used biblical illustration to show that baptism and salvation are independent from each other is the thief on the cross. So Jesus is being crucified, and he has a conversation with the dude nailed to the cross next to him, and the guy repents of his sins, and Jesus says, today, you'll be with me in paradise. Let me tell you what the Roman centurions didn't do. The Romans didn't go, oh man, that dude wants to go to heaven. Let's pull him off the cross, get John the Baptist in a big tank, let us baptize this guy and re-crucify him. So this guy on the cross was never baptized, but yet Jesus said, today you'll be with me in paradise. Now, I don't say that to downplay baptism. I just want us to be theologically on the same plane. And it's because of that that moms and dads, you don't have to be in a rush to try to baptize your child. That baptism is something that we need to participate in when we fully understand what it means.
Right.
When we fully realize that the blood of Jesus has washed us clean, baptism is the representation that we understand that thing. Baptism is an outward representation of the covenant between you and Jesus. Everyone say covenant.
Covenant.
That's an important word that we need to understand. When Jesus died to forgive our sins, he made a new covenant for us to enter into. There was a new thing. We no longer had to take animal sacrifices to a priest. We now could be saved through grace because of what Jesus did. And getting baptized is the public declaration of us showing the world that we're in covenant with Christ. It's us letting everybody know, hey, y'all, me and Jesus, we're connected. We're in relationship together. This is us signing on the dotted line that we have made a decision to follow Jesus. Have you ever been to a wedding? At a wedding, both people have to say, I do. It'd be kind of weird if you went to a wedding and the groom was like, I do. And the bride was like, let's get to the next part, right? Would be like, this is not good. This is not working out. Because when you get baptized, that's you saying, I do. I am in relationship. I have accepted the forgiveness of Jesus. And so I'm just letting it be known. I've met guys before that that they'll be in a dating relationship, but they won't put it on their social media profile. You seen this before? And so the girl, she's got it posted everywhere. They're eating dinner and kissing, and she's dating in a dating relationship, and he's still got, like, it's complicated, or, like, he won't even put what it is. You know what it is he's in a relationship with her, but he's unwilling to make it public.
Right.
And I think that a lot of times that for Christians that refuse to be obedient in the step of water baptism, we're kind of doing the same thing to Jesus. We want to accept the forgiveness. We want to accept everything that he has for us, but we never make the public declaration that we're in covenant with him. And so this is what baptism does. It lets the world know. Baptism shows that you're a follower of Christ. It identifies to the world that you connect with his message. Galatians chapter 3, verse 27, it says, for all of you who are baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. Clothe yourself. It's about to be Super Bowl Sunday. And so a whole bunch of people are going to be wearing jerseys. They're going to clothe themselves in their team, right? They're identifying, that's my team. Here at Living Church, if we do a big outreach like at Rockin' Forth or something, we give everybody a Living Church t-shirt. You put it on, you clothe yourself, you're now identifying yourself with this church. And so Jesus is saying that through baptism, you're identifying, you're clothing yourself with the message of the gospel. So baptism is not salvation, but identification. We on the same page? Okay. And it shows that you're in covenant with him. Romans 6, I think, is the greatest portion of Scripture that really shows us the theology around baptism. It says this in verse 3. Don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We're baptized into his death, that we are baptized into the grave. I talked to a friend of mine a couple weeks ago, one of the missionaries that we support here at Living Church, Aaron Henry in Durban, South Africa. And I asked him how things were going, and he told me, things are going great, Pastor. We had a baptism service just a couple weeks ago. 20 people got baptized from this tribe that we're doing ministry in. I said, that's incredible, man. Tell me about it. And he said, well, over here we don't have the same kind of baptism tanks that you guys have in the States. He said, so what we did is we got out and we dug a hole, and then we put a tarp down in the hole. Then we brought buckets of water and we filled up the hole and people got baptized there. And he said, but something really interesting happened. He said, while we were digging the hole, people would walk by and they would ask us, who died? Right. So if you're in Africa and there's some dude digging a big hole, right, Someone's about to get buried. And he said, at first they would say, oh no, we're doing baptism. People would be confused. And then he said, we started telling them, 20 people have died. They're all getting buried here on Sunday. You should come and see it. Because, see, it helped them understand what was happening. And when you get baptized, the old you dies in a watery grave. It's an identification of the world. The guy you used to know is getting murdered next Sunday. And so he's getting laid to rest, and the new me is going to be resurrected. Look what it says. It goes on and says, we were therefore buried with him through the baptism into death. Listen, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, you too may live a new life. That when we're baptized, that the old man, the old woman is washed away. It's washed away, and you're able to live a new life. Baptism signifies the old you is dead, and you're now living a new life. It puts everybody on notice. It puts your friends and your family and the devil on notice that the old me is dead and I am new. So I was thinking about this this week and chewing on it and thinking about it, and I realized that baptism isn't the first time that something dies in the water in the Bible. I thought, well, I could talk about Noah and the flood, but I don't got time to get into the two at the same time. So then I thought, well, there's another time that something died in the water, and I remember the story of the Israelites leaving Egypt. Remember, the Israelites were in bondage. They're in captivity for hundreds of years under the Egyptians. So Moses comes, says, let my people go. And so they all start to leave after the 10 plagues. God sent plagues, and the last plague was the death angel. And the death angel was going to kill the firstborn of every house unless the father of the home took the blood of a lamb and painted it over the doorpost. When he did, the death angel would pass over their home. And so then they were saved. There was freedom. There was relief from judgment because of the blood that they posted on their doorpost. And so all the Israelites, they leave Egypt, and as they're leaving, they're marching towards the Red Sea. Well, Pharaoh has a change of heart because he wants the thing that left him back. Can I tell you, just because you've been saved doesn't mean the enemy doesn't still want you back. The enemy starts chasing. So it says that Pharaoh gets all of his chariots and all of his men of war to begin to chase the Israelites. Well, the Bible also tells us the Israelites had no men of war, that they had no weapons, they had no soldiers. But what they did have was a covenant. They had a covenant with God that the death angel would pass over them and that he would bring them into freedom. And so as the Israelites are walking away and the chariots are chasing and they get to the Red Sea, they don't know what to do. And so Moses pulls out his staff, a representation of the cross, and he holds the staff out, and the Bible says that God has the Red Sea split. It says this in Exodus chapter 14. It says, so the people of Israel walked through the middle of the sea on dry ground with walls of water on each side of them. Theologians tell us that the water would have stacked up six stories high. So the sea splits, God dries up the ground, the thing they would have got stuck in gets dried up so they can. He makes a way where there is no way, and they start to walk through the water. They go down into something to come up out of something. The Bible says that as the chariots were chasing, that God sends a wall of smoke and fire to stop the Egyptians. So the Israelites are going through the water, and that right as the last Israelite takes a step out of the water, God lifts the wall of smoke and fire. So here comes the Egyptians, and the walls are still open, and they come chasing through. The Israelites are on the other side watching, no men of war, no soldiers, but they have a covenant. Sometimes we don't understand why our past is chasing us, but what we have to understand is that God has the enemy right where he wants them, that God has a plan to benefit you. And right as the last Israelite steps out of the sea and all the Egyptians are in the middle of the water, God lets the water crash down upon the Egyptians and drowns the entire army of the superpower of the planet to protect those that is in covenant with him. Can I tell you, the only thing that made it out of the water was that which had covenant with God. Hello, baptism. And so when we get baptized, the only thing that makes it out of the water is the thing that is in covenant with God. The old you is buried and dead, and the new you is alive and it's risen again. You know, and I've learned in my life that you never really live until something in you dies. That until you're able to kill some stuff in you that you don't want, you don't really have the ability to be free. But the Bible says that whom the Son sets free is free indeed, that there's a whole new level of life that God has for us. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, because of what Jesus did, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. And so you see, whenever that old sinful nature tries to come back and grab you after baptism, you have to say, hey, no, I killed you. Sometimes old trusting tries to come back. old Tristan tries to grab my ankle from the grave and say, yeah, but you're still insecure. Yeah, but you're still bound up in sin. Yeah, but you still have this addiction in your life. And I have to look at that thing and say, hey, fool, I already killed you. I already buried you. And so we don't listen to dead things. We don't listen to the things from the past because we understand that we are new. Romans chapter 6, it goes on and it says, for we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be done away with. That your old body, that your old flesh would be done away with. And it says that we would no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been freed from sin. So next week, we've already got about 20 people signed up for baptism that are ready to kill them old selves. We're about to murder some people next Sunday. Call the police, have them here. Some people getting murdered next week. Just the miraculous thing is that God brings them back from the dead. That the old man, some of y'all are like, what is happening in this church? That God is going to wash away the old you so that you knew you can step into all that he has for you. That's how we do it. This is how we do it. And so this morning I've got one more thing I want to say about baptism. But if you're here, you say, Pastor, you know, I've never accepted Jesus into my heart as my Lord and Savior. I've never allowed the blood of Jesus to forgive me and cleanse me from my sin. We want to give you that opportunity today. So all across this room, if you would close your eyes and bow your heads, if you'd say, you know, I want to ask God into my heart. I want to be made new. I want to know that I would step into eternity and be in relationship with God. On the count of three, I'd ask that you would just raise your hand and look up at me. We're not going to stand you up. We just want to pray a prayer with you from your heart to God's heart that's asking God to forgive you of your sin. If that's you, on the count of three, just quickly raise it up. One, two, three. Yeah, does everyone say this? Dear God, forgive me my sin and come into my heart. From this day forward, I'm going to live for you. My past is gone and my future is bright. I love you, Lord. Amen. Can we put our hands together for our friends that made that decision?